Let's go to Joliet, Illinois, where Rachel Ventura is standing by. She is running for the 11th Congressional District in Illinois. She is a Democrat, and she is challenging an incumbent who's also a Democrat, Bill Foster. Welcome, Rachel Ventura.
Thank you for having me on.
Well, you've been endorsed by Howie Klein and the Blue America PAC, so anybody who Howie Klein endorses, we endorse. And people should go to rachelventura.com. And if you're listening to us in the United States, donate money. Give her some money to help her defeat Congressman Bill Foster, a Democrat. We want to defeat Bill Foster in the primaries, and we want Rachel Ventura to get the Democratic nomination for Congress for Illinois' 11th district. Thank you for doing this. So you're in Joliet. Let's talk about Howie Klein for a second, if you don't mind.
Sure.
Okay. We have a Democrat, Bill Foster. He's serving the 11th district. Why are you challenging a Democrat? Why does Howie Klein want to get rid of Bill Foster? Without attacking Bill Foster, why do you think Howie Klein doesn't like Bill Foster?
Well, I think I'll start by answering why I decided to run against him, and then I'll answer why I think Howie doesn't want Bill to win. So in 2018, I was elected to the Will County Board, and after I was elected, a local group, the Our Revolution group, came to me and asked if I would go speak with our congressman as an elected official and talk about why it's important to have Medicare for all. And I, you know, said, absolutely. So in February of this year, we sat down with him and discussed the JOB Health Medicare for All bill.
You're talking about Bill Foster. You sat down with Bill Foster.
Correct. And there was a lot of questions and a lot of concerns, and you know, he needed some more answers. So we said, great, we will research everything on the bill, we'll get the answers you need, and we'll come back to you. We rescheduled several times then to try and get back in front of him. Eventually, in early May, he told us that he just had to cancel our meeting after rescheduling multiple times because he could only meet with one constituent per issue per year, and we had already met with him on Medicare for All. So we found that unacceptable. So our Revolution and myself planned a rally his offices. We did notify him in the press. And so he told the press that after the rally, he would meet with us on this issue. And we had a lot of supporters come out. And then in the end, he did not meet with us. He had his staff meet with us and tell us that they felt ACA was an affordable option, even though 29 million Americans still remain either underinsured or without insurance. I myself went 2 years without insurance because the ACA just was not affordable. We were looking at anywhere, my family paying $6,000 to $13,000 per year, or I could pay the $1,200 tax penalty for not having insurance and pray that I don't get sick.
Right.
So, as a single mom, it just wasn't in the cards for me to pay that type of money for myself. My children are covered under the best universal health care that we currently have in this country, which is called TRICARE. It's a it's a health care option to military families and active duty. So I know what a universal health care can look like. But it was shortly after that we had another group rally his offices on the Green New Deal, and he and his as a scientist, you know, we thought he would be open to this. And he said it's basically a pipe dream, and he wouldn't co-sponsor it. And so at that point, I was like, okay, it's time to enter this race. These are both huge issues that our congressman isn't taking seriously. So I think Howie also recognizes that, you know, the climate crisis is something that we are behind the eight ball on. And it's much needed, but even though it's our biggest threat, the Green New Deal offers a solution to not just getting off of fossil fuels, but also to closing the wealth gap in America. So to me, it's a no-brainer to get onto this. But more than that, in 2018, Bill Foster voted against the ADA to gut their civil liberties and put businesses first. It was basically saying that the businesses didn't need to come into compliance with the 29-year-old law for ADA. And it was Tammy Duckworth here in the state for the Senate who threatened, who got all the Democrats on board in the Senate to threaten a filibuster if they called the bill, and they didn't. But he was one of 12 Democrats, part of his new Dems caucus, who voted with the Republicans to pass that bill forward.
Okay.
So by putting businesses first, that's definitely a problem.
Okay. The ADA is the Americans with Disabilities Act.
Correct.
And Tammy Duckworth is a veteran who
yes.
came back missing some limbs.
Yes.
Right.
One of her legs. Mm-hmm.
Okay. The ADA and the ACA is really Obamacare.
Correct. Affordable Care Act.
The Affordable Care Act. Okay. Just so we're clear. Bill Foster, you say, does not support Medicare for All, and yet he's a Democrat.
Correct.
Is he a Harvard PhD?
He does have a PhD. I'm not sure what university it's from.
He went to Harvard.
Okay.
So he's part of the problem. I believe in breaking up big Harvard. If you went to Harvard, you automatically assume that you're smart and that these things are difficult, but because I'm a technocrat, I know what's possible. And, you know, the Affordable Care Act, we can work with Obamacare. We can make it better because he's a Harvard kid. And, you know, it's a lot more difficult than you think it is. So, in principle, for Medicare for All. I like the idea of Medicare for All, but, you know, how are you going to pay for it?
Well, I think the $600,000 he took from Big Pharma and insurances also has something to do with that answer.
He took how much from Big Pharma?
$600,000.
$600,000 from Big Pharma. And the health insurance? Is that
and insurance companies. Mm-hmm.
Total $600,000.
Yep.
Hmm. So he's opposed to Medicare for All. He thinks we can improve upon Obamacare. Why is that not true? Why can't we improve on Obamacare? Why is that just a fallacy?
Well, I think one of the best things that came out of Obamacare was the getting rid of pre-existing conditions. I know many families could not get insurance or any affordable insurance because of that. And so in that regard, it was a great stepping stone. But then we never took the next step. We never continued to bring prices down. Insurance companies saw this as an opportunity to increase premiums. And so we're in a situation we're in now. And it's, you know, insurance continues to also dictate care, tells you what doctor you can see, whether in-network or not out-of-network. They have artificial prices for one zip code over other zip codes. You know, and a lot of it's all about the profit. That's not a healthcare system. Right. That's not a healthcare system. That is insurance. I mean, I guess on one hand, we can't blame them. They're doing what they told us they would do. Insurance is a bet against the catastrophic from happening. So generally, we have life insurance. That catastrophic thing is the end of life. With initially, with insurance, it was, you know, having something like a heart attack or cancer or surgery. But the actuaries actually saw that by including health checkups, they could better guess if someone was going to need some of those cares, but it could also decrease some of that. So, again, going back to the profits, by allowing people to see their doctor on a regular basis, it improved the risk status of that patient, or at least allowed the insurance companies to better ID them and then set their premiums accordingly. What ended up happening then was morphing out of that, oh, you can go to the doctor for your health care, was, you know, health checkups was, well, now I have this other thing, you know, this cold, this flu. And so, it became this faux health care. And when we saw other countries getting health care, then, you know, Americans were like, oh, I'll go to my doctor and get this covered as well. And so on one hand, it makes sense that they continue to increase the premiums if you're going to them more often, because it's supposed to be a bet against getting sick, not, you know, an ongoing care. So when Medicare for All, the improved and expanded system, would actually be health care, because what you are paying for is those doctor rates and those hospital rates. Our government would set them across the board, much like they do for TRICARE today, and then you would pay a deductible that would go, that money would go into an account, and then when you went to the hospital, the government would pay out of that account the price of your doctor appointment or whatever treatment you may need. And there wouldn't be this in-between insurance company dictating whether or not that doctor was in-network or out-of-network. You know, everybody would have to either take the government rates or not be in business. You know, that would just be how it is. So you could choose what doctor you went to based on the level of care they provided or how, you know, you liked the doctor or didn't like the doctor, and you wouldn't have to go get pre-authorizations and all these other things. You would have actual health care. And that's the difference between having an insurance company or an insurance system and a healthcare system.
But it sounds like you want to throw 180 million Americans off their private health insurance. You know, that sounds pretty scary. You know, most Americans love their insurance companies.
I would argue that nobody loves their insurance companies. They love their doctors and their hospitals that they can go to. They love getting care, right? I mean, I'm not calling up my insurance company and saying, I'm so lucky I have you that I have to call and argue with you every single time I get a bill.
Mm-hmm. But that's what Joe Biden said during the debates. He says Medicare for All would take close to 200 million Americans off their private health insurance. And what about the unions that fought so hard for benefits? And so
that was all in vain, I guess.
The whole union movement was in vain if you're going to switch to Medicare for All, right?
Yeah, well, I would hope that the unions would look at this in two different ways. The first is solidarity that, you know, we want everybody to have living wage jobs that, that provide good health care. So by taking the health care package, you know, out of the negotiation table, it allows us to, you know, get half of that right off the bat. The other half will come through, you know, passing the Green New Deal will provide, it's a $16 trillion job package. So it will provide living wage jobs across the country so people can go get those jobs. But also by taking it off the negotiation table, it allows union members to fight harder for their raise and step increases versus having to forego some of their raises just because of their health care. And in the long run, some of those health care costs end up costing this the union member more money than if they would have got the raise to begin with. So I understand that they have fought hard over the years for health care, but this is a benefit not just to the unions, but to everybody else in America too.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. What is the biggest issue facing America? Is it Medicare for All?
I would say it's I guess it depends on how you ask that question. The first thing I would say is it's a wealth gap. But at the same point, if we don't save our planet for us to live on, the wealth gap doesn't mean much in 10, 20 years. So the existential threat, of course, is the climate crisis. You know, we have to make sure that this world is sustainable for everyone. And there's been lots of reports that said, you know, people of color and the lower social economics in our country and in the world, they will be hit first. And so we need to make sure that we are being responsible in what we're doing here in this country, what we're doing in the world, in order to provide a world for everyone. And I do believe that our government has to work for everyone, and currently it's not. And that kind of weaves into the wealth gap. We're seeing more and more Americans, you know, the rich become richer and the poor become poorer, so you have a lot more have-nots than haves. And sure, I would say that that started more so with, you know, your lower end, now it's into your middle class, but it's starting to hit more and more of what I would consider white America. And so it's not just hitting people of color anymore. It's not just hitting the poor. It's starting to hit people who once were very secure in their salaries are becoming more income insecure. And we're going to see more of that as the middle class continues to disappear. So, you know, the Green New Deal, again, that job package is investing back into our economy. And so that will provide, you know, allow us to recycle our money in Main Street once again, right?
Yeah.
So if I have a better job, I buy more stuff, then that creates businesses in town. You know, restaurant owners make more money. The hair salon makes more money. And then those individuals spend that money. And so it continues to recycle.
It's the multiplier
tax dollars.
Yeah.
Yep, exactly.
Okay. When I get up in the morning, I know that I have to do one thing first, and we know what that is. And then after I do that, I decide, okay, what's the second most important thing that I have to do? And the way we get things done is step by step and making choices and prioritizing. My priority is Medicare for All. I don't think you can fight for the climate unless everybody has access to healthcare. We need a healthy population. And then we can tackle everything else. By the way, let me just go off and tell you that's why I hate Beto O'Rourke. I think he's a fraud and a fool who resorts to the F-bombs, and he actually tweeted out the S-word for excrement. He's now cursing because he really doesn't have any ideas. He just wants to be cute. And he decided to be a flamethrower and say, we're going to confiscate your AR-15s. He said that during the debate. I happen to agree that we have to get rid of the AR-15s. I'm fine with going door to door and taking away the AR-15s. I am. But that's not my first priority. My first priority is Medicare for All. My second priority is the Green New Deal. And that, as you say, bleeds into income inequality. I'm all for gun control. But that's my problem with Beto. He's a fraud and a fool, and he is desperately looking for an issue to get people to fall in love with him. I really, really, really hate Beto O'Rourke. This is a problem that I should not be discussing with you. I apologize. But
I will give you some good news, not about Beto, but about the Green New Deal. Is in there, that one of the line items on the, it's a framework on there, is Medicare for All. It's health care for everyone.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Even written in the Green New Deal is your number one priority. And yeah. I think that also speaks to the wealth gap. Like, as you said, people can't, it doesn't matter if your income goes up, if you're spending it all on health care. So that's part of the wealth gap for sure.
Yeah. You have to have priorities. What is Absolutely. Really important? You can't be scattered. And Beto is scattershot. Oh, let's try this. Confiscate the AR-15s. Ooh, the crowd went wild. I should stick with that. So your number one priority is income inequality and not Medicare for All.
Well, I think it all rolls in together. I mean, and when I look at the issues, the climate change, the wealth inequalities, the health care, all of that is nicely packaged in passing the Green New Deal.
Right.
So by focusing on getting that done, we've eliminated those top three priorities. So yours may be healthcare. My children's is definitely climate crisis, you know.
Right.
And then for me, I have to deal with financial insecurities every day as a single mom. So
right.
For me, that is a concern. I can't worry about whether or not I change the light bulb to an LED or not when I can't afford the light bulb to begin with.
So Democrat Bill Foster. Bill Foster, the congressman, Democrat from the 11th district in Illinois. You want to unseat him. Who is he working for? He's a Democrat. Who is he working for? He gets up every morning and says, I want to help whom?
Yeah, well, that's a great question. It doesn't seem like his constituents at this point. He has taken a lot of money from financial services. He does sit on the financial service committee right now. You know, they're currently looking at merging the sixth largest bank. So I'm not sure that we learned anything from the 2008 too big to fail bank bailout that we gave. He rolled back restrictions on Dodd-Frank as well after the
really?
Bailout.
So really?
We're, if we're headed towards another housing crisis, we're sure not doing the right things in Congress that would help protect us from having another 08 crash. Yeah.
I was going through Down with Tyranny, Howie Klein's blog. And back in 2007, Howie Klein was railing against the former mayor of Chicago, Rahm Emanuel, who at the time was running the DCCC, and Rahm Emanuel was behind Bill Foster. And Rahm Emanuel, I think we have to purge the Democratic Party. This is not something that you can talk about, but people like Rahm Emanuel, they have turned the Democratic Party into the Republican Party. Rahm Emanuel is one of the reasons a lot of Americans don't vote. There are 100 million Americans who could vote but don't because they don't see a difference between the two parties. If you don't win the nomination. And Bill Foster gets the nomination once again. Would you vote for Bill Foster for Congress? He's running for re-election. If you lose the primary, would you vote for him in the general?
Well, I think it's
and
a
how do you
question,
sell? And
I'm
how
going
do you
to
sell?
Win.
You're going to win. I know you're going to win. And people have to go to rachelventura.com and hit the donate button. If you're listening to me in the United States, if you're listening to us overseas, you cannot donate money. Only American citizens can donate to Rachel Ventura. But if you're listening to us overseas, forward her website to some friends here in the United States, and they can donate. But how do you sell Bill Foster to liberal, well, liberals, to leftists, to people who...
Well, what it really comes down to is if we thought we could move Bill Foster, then I wouldn't be running in this race. And we tried. It's not like we just said, okay, we're going to run this race today. You know, we went to him several times. We contacted his offices. We gave him information about the bill, Green New Deal, and Medicare for All. And we talked about these important things with him multiple times. Even after I entered the race, I sent him a text message and said, you know, I'm just checking one more time. I've had other Democrats ask me to reach out to you and make sure that you're, you know, unwilling to move on this, basically. And he said to me, welcome to the race. So at the end of the day, you know, is he going to move to the left? Is he going to do what's right for his constituencies? You know, 70% of Americans want and need expanded and improved Medicare for All. So mm-hmm. Is he going to be a voice for them? You know, I can't answer that. I'm not Bill Foster. But what I can answer is I will be a voice for them, and I will vote for these things, and I will push what is right for constituents, and I will sit there and listen to what constituents need and then make my choices accordingly. So, you know, on March 17th, we do believe that we will win this race because we are taking this race to the voters and we are listening to them. And that's something that I don't feel Bill Foster is doing.
And it's a safe Democratic stronghold. In other words, when
we're
in
a D plus nine. Yep.
D plus nine. That means you win your district by 9 points. So why wouldn't the Democrats show their true colors if it's that safe? Or are they showing their true colors? I mean, it's a safe district. You can send anybody you want to Congress, DCCC, and you're sending Bill Foster, who doesn't support
Medicare. Well, I think a lot of it, too, especially in today's political atmosphere, is that the Democratic Party is not encouraging primaries. Very much the opposite of that. They're discouraging. They've told our the associate chairs that they are to endorse the incumbents. And so I've got five different counties in this race, and only two of the five actually endorsed Bill Foster. But the other three went against the wishes of the party to do so. And then, you know, they've blacklisted consultants from working on races like this. And to me, that's very sad. That is chipping away at our democracy. We want to have a voice. We want multiple people on the ballot. We want to have, you know, I want somebody to represent me, you want someone to represent you, and they may not always be the same, but that's where our votes come in. And if I want to get out there and knock doors for a candidate because I feel that strong about it, and you don't feel that strongly about it, and you don't want to knock doors or donate, mm-hmm. that's fine. But then that ends up, you know, me getting out there helps persuade why it's important to me. And that's our democracy directly in play when you are trying to find a representative to represent you. But if you're only giving them one option on the ticket over and over again, then it's easy for that person to not represent you or want to represent you. If they know that they're comfortable in that seat and no one's going to challenge them, then it's easy to do the votes that maybe hurt you so they can bring in a little bit more donor dollars. It's a lot harder when you know in 2 years someone else is going to be on that ticket, and you had to make sure that you did what was right for the voters. Otherwise, those voters are going to vote you out.
Yeah.
Right? That's what we hold our politicians accountable through the voting process. And so it is super important that we have access to primaries and we have candidates willing to run.
Right. I'll let you go. I have a general rule of thumb for Democrats. If your candidate went to Harvard, don't vote for him. If your candidate went to Yale or Princeton, don't vote for him. They don't belong in the Democratic Party. People who graduated from Harvard, Yale, and Princeton, they are not candidates of the people. you know, they can eat all the corn dogs they want at the Iowa State Fair, and you can have a beer with them. But if they went to Harvard, Yale, or Princeton, they're not on your side. They will listen to pollsters who will tell them what to say to make it look like they're comfortable in their own skin. But they're ambitious, and they're elitists, and they're not particularly smart. They just know how to succeed because of their ambition. You know, this guy, Bill Foster, I read up on him. Now, he's got his Harvard PhD, and he's super smart, supposedly. He had his own Rick Perry moment during a debate the same year. Remember Governor Rick Perry of Texas, who doesn't pretend to be anything other than an idiot? Rick Perry's an idiot from Texas, a tool of the oil companies. Remember his oops moment during the 2012 debates where he said, I'm going to eliminate three cabinet departments once I'm elected president. Those three cabinet departments are education, energy, and oops. Remember that? That and Mr.
What do we need education for, right?
Yeah. And so Bill Foster, the same year, he's the congressman representing the 11th District of Illinois. He's a Democrat. And during his debate, just like Rick Perry, he promised that he would eliminate three parts of the federal budget. This is what he said. He said, we're going to get rid of military aircraft funding, crop insurance subsidies, and the third thing, oops. He had his own Rick Perry moment. His mind went blank because he's a nothing. He really is. You can't say that, but I will. Don't vote for anybody who's a Democrat who went to Harvard, Yale, or Princeton. They're not on your side. They're just trained to convince you that they are. Rachel Ventura is on your side. Go to rachelventura.com and give her money. If you're an American citizen, give Rachel Ventura some money to defeat Bill Foster in the primaries. Go to rachelventura.com. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me.
Can you stay on the line for 1 second, Rachel?
Yep.